All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome, good afternoon, and thank you for coming to the second event of the academic year here at the Azrieli Institute of Israel Studies. And this is our first faculty graduate student seminar. This is a format that we run this event in this particular format usually two or three times during the year, and this year this is the first time that we are pairing a couple of faculty members together with one of our promising and bright graduate students. Because Lindsay is a busy graduate student, she's on her way as we speak from down the hill to arrive here up the hill. And so I'm not going to introduce her until she actually arrives, which means that I'm going to start the session with a brief introduction of our first speaker, Professor Bina Freiwald, who is joining us from the Department of English at Concordia University. Dr. Freiwald is a very active member of the academic advisory group that we have here at the Institute, and she's also currently director of the Humanities PhD Program at the Center for Interdisciplinary Studies in Society and Culture, which I believe is based still at the Faculty of Arts and Science. To those of us, to those of you who are active in various Israel Studies events, conferences, networks, Bina needs no introduction, because she's been a long-standing member and participant at the annual meetings of the Association for Israel Studies and other related projects. Her research and teaching interests focus on critical theory, women's writing, issues of gender and sexuality, and with specific focus on Jewish studies and Israel studies with Canadian content. She's examining the diaspora's woman identity and belonging in contemporary Jewish Canadian writing. I also want to mention another one of Bina's projects, which is called Gender, Nation, and Self-Narration, the construction of national and diasporic identities in Jewish women's life narratives in Palestine/Israel and Canada between the years of 1880 and 1948. Mm-hmm. Professor Freiwald earned her bachelor's degree at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, and her graduate degrees were obtained here at McGill University in Montreal. So in Bina, we have a finest combination of not only scholarship, but also Israeli and Canadian local Montreal personal touch and connection. Without further ado, I turn the floor to Professor Freiwald, who will speak for exactly 22 minutes.
Thanks very much, Csaba, for the introduction, and thank you all for coming. Ambivalence, representations of Israel in contemporary Jewish Canadian writing. What is this democracy of the chosen? Jonathan Garfinkel asks in his book, Ambivalence, Crossing the Israel-Palestine Divide, published in 2007, an account of his extended visit to Israel and meetings with a wide range of Jewish Israelis from different backgrounds and political orientations, as well as with Palestinians. This double focus on Garfinkel's book as exemplifying an attempt by contemporary Jewish Canadian writers to grapple with what they see as a fundamental tension within Israel's self-definition as a Jewish and democratic state. A tension between, on the one hand, a universalizing liberal democratic vision for the state premised on justice and equality for all of its citizens, and on the other, a particularistic vision in which the state becomes an instrument of and for the Jewish ethno-religious nation. I'm particularly interested in the dilemmas that arise out of this tension for contemporary Jewish Canadian writers whose experiences in Israel have compelled them to re-examine what Jewishness means to them and reflect on the idea of a Jewish nation state. Two striking examples are The Garden and the Gun, A Journey Inside Israel by Erna Peres, published in 1988, and Jonathan Garfinkel's 2007 Ambivalence. Memoirs that center on their authors' respective extended visits to Israel/Palestine. Erna Peres' stay was in the months leading up to the First Intifada, and Garfinkel first came to Israel in 2004 and then returned in 2006, that is, during and in the aftermath of the Second Intifada. The memoirs have much in common beyond giving voice to a wide range of Israelis and Palestinians. Both authors recognize that they enter the actual Israel carrying within them another Israel, what Erna Peres calls the country of the mind, a product of their Jewish upbringing that has become part of their internal landscape of belonging. And both quickly realize that the challenge ahead, as Garfinkel puts it, is to figure out, quote, how the myths of my past and the realities of the present can live together so that he could be at peace with himself. Internal turmoil arises for Garfinkel and Peres as a result of the gap between their secular, liberal sense of Jewishness, grounded, as Erna Peres writes, in a passionate humanism, and Israeli reality, particularly the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and the lack of separation between religion and state. Thus, both memoirs conclude with a sense of anguish. Erna Peres feels she has come up against, quote, a blank wall of despair. And as Garfinkel prepares to return to Canada, he imagines God having decided to give the biblical Moses the surprise of his life, taking him on a tour of contemporary Israel. Moses is distressed at the sight of the giant scar in the land that is the separation wall, and challenges God. Are these, quote, his people too, these children of Abraham, Isaac, and Ishmael? God, writes Garfinkel in the memoir's closing pages, starts to cry. Garfinkel's and Peres' memoirs explore the issues that lead them to this sense of despair. And Garfinkel's book is particularly revealing as he self-reflexively examines Israel from the perspective of a contemporary secular diasporic Jew who has been raised as a liberal Zionist, but who has come to question the primacy of ethnic or religious affiliations when it comes to citizenship and the state. The memoir as a whole could be seen as playing out a central tension between what political theorists identify as two possible models for the liberal democratic state. One, arguably a Canadian model that recognizes the state as multinational and seeks to universalize citizenship and not make it contingent on ethnic or religious identity. And an Israeli model in which the state and the ethno-religious nation are seen as inextricable. Garfinkel's memoir opens with his arrival at the Ben Gurion Airport. When questioned by an airport security official, he is reluctant to say much. The official, going through the contents of Garfinkel's suitcase, finds a notebook with Hebrew writing. It is Garfinkel's fourth grade assignment on the history of Jerusalem, written when he was a student at Bialik Jewish Day School. Seeing this, the official is reassured, but puzzled, he asks, why didn't you say so? Garfinkel doesn't answer, but tells us, I'd like to enter this place without tribe, history, identity. The idea is ridiculous. I mean, look where I am. Garfinkel's memoir can be seen as an extended meditation on the extent and impact of these forces of the tribe on both collective identity and individual destiny. And since it is an autobiography and not a political essay, its particular strength lies in Garfinkel's nuanced exploration of both the ideological, but also the affective, the emotional facets of his relation to the tribe and to Israel. At the heart of such an exploration of identity lies, not surprisingly, the question of home and belonging. At the critical moment in the memoir, Garfinkel imagines being asked, will you come home? Instead of an answer, the four sections of the memoir entitled Departures, Arrival, Landing, and Return dramatize a shuttling between locations, Canada and Israel, Palestine, rather than any progression towards a destination. They dramatize a series of equivocations and questionings rather than a movement towards an affirmative answer. Tellingly, towards the end of the memoir, Garfinkel puts to Kabina, a Sinai Bedouin, the question that haunts his own search. What does home mean? When Kabina, the veteran, does not respond, Garfinkel interprets his silence to mean, you don't ask that question. One does not ask that question of what home means to you, I would suggest, because the answer should be self-evident. And the question of what home means only arises when the very terms of the individual's identity and his or her belonging are in doubt. Such is indeed Garfinkel's predicament. About Canada, he writes, we were perfectly content with our lives there, but it was also by the collectivity's own self-perception, a diasporic and thus an uncertain belonging. Quote, what would Jews be without the state of Israel? And should time in the diaspora ever get bad, for a Jew is never completely safe, there was always Israel to go to, Yerushalayim, our safety net, eternal refuge, end quote. Yet in Israel, he has to contend, on the one hand, with the reality of the displaced 1948 Palestinian internal refugees in a village like Tabra in the Galilee, birthplace of his Palestinian friend, Rana, and on the other, with a boy in the Orthodox Meshach neighborhood, who throws stones at him shouting, go away, and Garfinkel is left wondering, go where? This question is further amplified when he cannot ideologically reconcile the Israeli reality he witnesses with the key tenets of his liberal Zionist Jewish Canadian upbringing, with its emphasis on, quote, the universal values of social justice and commitment to class struggle in the name of the Jewish state, end quote. I therefore see Garfinkel's memoir as driven by a set of interrelated questions. Who am I? Where do I belong? What do I believe in? Questions that come into a particularly sharp focus for him in Israel-Palestine. So I've organized my thoughts on the memoir and his search for answers to these questions in three brief sections under the titles Ideology Critique, Affect, and One Ideology Critique. As post-1967 accounts of Israel filtered through a North American Jewish secular liberal sensibility, Erna Peres' and Garfinkel's memoirs, like recent fiction by such contemporary Jewish Canadian writers as Edith Ravel and Michael Tregebov, bear out Peter Beinart's contention in The Crisis of Zionism, 2012, that declining support or even interest in Israel among segments of North American Jewry, especially younger populations. This decline arises from opposition to the occupation, which is viewed as a failure to, quote, wield Jewish power ethically. However, Garfinkel's questioning goes beyond that, since he takes on the broader existential question of how could Israel reconcile the universalizing principles of liberal democracy with a particularistic vision of a Jewish state that is ethnically and religiously defined. Peter Beinart opens the first chapter of The Crisis of Zionism by recognizing a fundamental tension between Zionism and liberal democracy. Quote, as a Zionist, I believe that the Jewish people deserve a state dedicated to their protection in their historic land. As a partisan of liberal democracy, I believe that a Jewish state must offer equal citizenship to all its inhabitants. At the heart of the Zionist project is the struggle to reconcile two valid but conflicting ideals. Mm-hmm. While Beinart remains optimistic but vague about how one might reconcile such conflicting ideals and focuses his polemic on the occupation, the tension between these two principles is central to Garfinkel's memoir. He writes, it's easier to protest the West Bank and Gaza and the implication are similar to withdraw now. But what does one do about the inequalities here in Israel? What is this democracy of the chosen? He cannot escape the full force of the contradiction. For example, when speaking to a group of left-wing artists from En Harod, for while readily recognizing that their kibbutz was built on an Arab village and refusing to go into the occupied territories, they cannot conceive of accepting a Palestinian into the kibbutz. Garfinkel writes, my mind is unraveling this home on unstable ground. unable to reconcile their position with what he had been taught about the foundational ideology of the kibbutz, itself exemplary of the Jewish ethos as articulated by his formidable Hebrew teacher and Bialik, Mrs. Blitzkrieg, who makes recurrent appearances throughout the memoir. She's this ghostly presence. And she used to say the kibbutz is a living example of equality, not only in terms of distribution of wealth, but human rights. Everyone is to be treated equally. Mrs. Blitzkrieg's voice, end quote. This country confuses the hell out of me, Garfinkel reels, and he's grappling with this confusion, his critique and search for answers throughout the memoir could be seen as dramatization on the micro level of the individual, of the political and conflictual dynamics described at the societal micro level by such Israeli scholars as Gershon Shafir and Yoav Pellet in their 2002 book, Being Israeli, The Dynamics of Multiple Citizenship. Shafir and Pellet argued that three partly contradictory political goals and commitments have fueled Israel's moral and political dilemma, namely colonialism, ethno-nationalism, and democracy. And they further make the case that during the first few decades of the state's existence, quote, the inclusionary principle of democracy and the exclusionary principle of Jewish nationalism could coexist only because they were mediated by republicanism as part of a colonial project of building the nation state and attaining national citizenship. It was, Shafir and Pellet write, always a precarious ideological configuration, since universalist rhetoric and partially universalist state building practices mask highly exclusionist policies with respect to Palestinians, Mizrahi Jews, and all women. The gradual weakening of the republican discourse in Israel, they argue, has coincided with the revitalization of the liberal and nationalist discourses, leaving them in an unmediated polarity, which accounts for the crisis atmosphere that characterizes Israeli politics at the present time, end quote. In Ambivalence, we witness Garfinkel experiencing this societal crisis at the personal level. Progressively, he feels, quote, that he is losing himself. And a key insight that emerges from this condition is his recognition that as an individual, he has internalized these conflicting principles of universalism and particularism, both pillars of his socialization as a diasporic Jew. A brief second section and then a brief third. When Garfinkel is challenged by an Orthodox friend, why are you so concerned about the occupation? He responds, because I feel like I'm occupied. By what? The thought is ridiculous, but I say it anyway, my faith. While Garfinkel concedes that it's like saying I've been born into a prison, he also asks himself, would you rather not have been occupied? And concludes, it's absurd, this question. It's like asking, would you rather not having been born? Garfinkel identifies these contradictory social terms which have formed his identity. On the one hand, a fierce attachment to Judaism, characterized above all by a strong sense of a humanist ethics. On the other hand, he says, in spite of everything I've seen, heard, and read about, I'm not willing to concede the land. I cannot abandon the idea of a Jewish state. On the one hand, it feels as natural as breathing to welcome the Sabbath bride with the singing of Lecha Dodi. On the other hand, he is choked by the instruction to the biblical Joshua to exterminate everything in the city of Jericho, which leads Garfinkel to conclude, quote, the promised land from the beginning had been about occupation. Very brief section, hopes. Final section. Garfinkel comes to Israel-Palestine hoping to find a model of Jewish-Palestinian coexistence. In a house in Jerusalem he'd heard about, shared by the Jewish Shimon and the Palestinian Abu Dalo. Israeli filmmaker Amos Gitai's documentary, Bayit House, was partly an inspiration for this. But what he finds is that Israel-Palestine is a place with, quote, too much history. Jews and Palestinians gather in groups, their presence asking the question, to whom do you belong? Are you with us or them? Israel and Palestine, the place shoves you towards a position. dialogue, he finds, becomes impossible under such conditions. And he feels stuck at the dead end in the journey and in myself. The only way to escape this cul-de-sac is invention. His way out of this maze is to search for a personal connection with the ancient teachings. And he finds it in the idea of moral choice and in this configuration of particularism and universalism. Quote, "What's left of my Jewishness is grounded in the message of the Zohar, Tikkun Olam. Let us work to mend our brokenness. Hallelujah." It is a vision that might be at odds with the particularistic mandate of a Jewish nation state, but it is clearly resonates with a recognizable, possibly growing North American Jewish sensibility. As Dov Waxman argues in his 2016 book, just came out, entitled Trouble in the Tribe, the American Jewish Conflict Over Israel, younger North American Jews are increasingly steering clear of Jewish establishment organizations that they see as characterized by their internal focus on Jewish identity and external focus on Israel. And they are opting instead for, quote, social justice and environmental activism, seen as a means for tikkun olam, repairing the world. As Garfinkel leaves Israel to return to Canada, like Erna Paris before him, and before them, Silva Gerber, a book I don't have time to talk about, author of the 1989 memoir, No Bomb in Gilead, a personal retrospective of Mandate Days in Israel. For all of them, it seems that the message that they're giving us as their readers is that the task of making the world a more hospitable place for all of us to call home has to be pursued from elsewhere. Thanks very much.
It's my turn. I already told you who I was, and of course it's great to see many old friends back around the table. It's very difficult to come last because there were very large shoes that were left for me to fill after Lindsay's and Bina's fantastic presentations. Now, the beauty of these faculty and graduate student seminars, I think, is that we really try to show and showcase the interdisciplinary nature of the enterprise that we do. I mean, you've seen from Bina's presentation, we moved from literature then to Lindsay's presentation, which is on somewhere, if I see it correctly, on the borderline of religious studies, Jewish studies, sociology, anthropology. Now I will try to take you to yet another direction. Comparative politics with a bit of a mathematical flavor. And there's a reason for that. So the title of the presentation is Avrasha Come Home, Avrasha Shuv Habayta. Some of you who are avid observers, or were avid observers of Israeli party politics back in the days might remember the famous line from former Prime Minister Yitzhak Shamir, who thus said to one of his former co-partisans, Avraham Sharir, in an effort to try to convince him to change his party affiliation yet again, third time in the same Knesset, in order to come back to join the fold of Likud, in order to allow Shamir to reform his previously collapsed government in the 12th Knesset. I will be speaking about Sharir only tangentially, but I did want to use the quote as a way of showcasing and illustrating the central point of the presentation, which is really about party defections and the instability of political parties during a major coalitional crisis in the history of Israel. Now, the stinking trick was the famous or infamous ploy maneuver that Shimon Peres orchestrated, again it may be very well known to some of you, together with Shas, in order to actually undermine and bring about the collapse of the Shamir government, in an effort to try to form a new coalition of the religious and the left-wing political parties. The stinking trick backfired, it didn't work, and what came out of that episode was the reformation and the formation of Shamir's new government, this time excluding the alignment, Labour, and bringing together the ideologically more aligned center and center-right political parties in the Knesset. Before I would go to the narrative, I do want to preface really the major point and the major puzzle of the presentation. That is, of course, intellectually intriguing and interesting for scholars of Israel and Israeli politics, but for comparative political scientists, it's really an important theoretical puzzle. Because those of us who study coalition politics in Israel and in other parts of the world, we see political parties form, undermine, make and break governments all the time. What we normally don't see is political parties disintegrating in the process. And this is what is so extremely interesting about the 1990 case in Israel, that you see a conventional, somewhat predictable coalition crisis, and as the crisis unfolds, instead of only political parties renegotiating a new deal and renegotiating the transition from one coalitional equilibrium to another, what you see is political parties changing identities as a result of cascading defections. And why does that happen? Is an important question. And I'm going to show you just a couple of slides later that the very phenomenon fundamentally questions several decades of conventional wisdom in the study of coalitional and legislative politics, legislative party politics, which rest on the assumption that political parties are unitary actors. There is variation in terms of party discipline, but usually even political parties that are not very disciplined and not very cohesive, the literature shows us that when it comes to forming or undermining a government, when it comes to making or breaking a government, parties overall in most advanced industrialized democracies behave as unitary actors. So what went wrong? What changed so fundamentally in 1990 leading up to 1990 in the first Knesset that actually resulted to the disintegration or the breakup of some of these parties, or rather what resulted in their sufferance of defections. So I'm going to come back to the theoretical points just in a moment, but just to recap, here is the basic timeline and the key points of the narrative. And really to start the story, you have to go back to the elections to the 11th Knesset, 1984, which results in a successful, not without difficulties, but a stable, lasting national unity government that brought together Likud and the alignment. That was a coalition that actually governed successfully for a period of 4 years. One important key to the success of this coalition was the rotation agreement, rotatia, which essentially divvied up the prime ministership between the two major partners in the coalition, and that seemed to take the edge off from competition for that high office. It's an important and interesting question to raise: what made rotatia, what made rotation credible, and in fact. There were doubts that the transition would midterm transition would actually take place, but it did. Nonetheless, after the 1988 election, another possibility emerges for another national unity government, at first Shamir, who was leading the largest party in the Knesset, Likud, and Likud was the largest party only by really a couple of seats, and somewhere I will have the detailed election results. Shamir at first seemed to be not interested in renewing the National Unity Coalition and actually starts talking with some of the smaller right-wing political parties, for example, Tzomet, Rafi Eitan's new formation, and the religious parties. In fact, Shamir goes all the way to conclude an agreement with Agudat Yisrael, one of the Orthodox Ashkenazi parties, to bring them into the coalition, until he changes his mind and leaving everybody and everything out to on the sidelines, he actually enters into a new national unity government with alignment led by Shimon Peres. Peres claims that he didn't, there are various conflicting records about it, there's indication that Peres didn't actually know about the agreement, that it was Rabin who negotiated this, and he was very upset that Rabin actually gave away what could have been a very powerful opposition opportunity. Peres was afraid that alignment would be a fig leaf potentially in this national unity government, And it's difficult to tell what actually went on, what the actual motivation was. But we do know that the new National Unity Agreement was without a rotation. There was no rotation agreement. In other words, when Shamir admits Perez and the alignment in the coalition, he makes no promise, no pledge to give up the prime ministership midterm, which, according to several commentators, gave a vested interest and created a built-in destabilizer into the government right from the beginning, giving the alignment leadership a desire to want to undermine the government in order to get back into power. And all of this comes out to the open when the leaders of the two main partners, so Shamir on the part of Likud and Perez from alignment, disagree about how to handle peace negotiations, in particular specific demands that came from the American administration in leading up to the Madrid conference. And alignment insisted that the government should make very clear positive overtures towards the Palestinian side and towards their partners in line with what the Americans had demanded. Shamir is much more careful, and he's also constrained by some of his constrained ministers from the Likud camp, who are demanding a much tougher line from within the party. The end of the story is that Alignment issued an ultimatum to Likud, demanding obedience or agreement with the American terms that the government received. In response to that, Shamir fires Perez and the rest of the alignment ministry, all the alignment ministers, the left ministers, leave the cabinet. And there is immediately a vote of no confidence filed against Yitzhak Shamir, which, for the first time ever in Israeli political history, the government loses. The government loses the vote of no confidence. Shamir loses the vote largely because Shas joined in the stinking trick alignment, and except for one of its members, Itzhak Peres, who was actually the nominal leader of the party, five members of Shas don't show up to vote, and on the count, the government collapsed. So now you have a government crisis. For the first time ever in the country's history, the incumbent prime minister and his government is voted out. On the day of the vote of no confidence, five members of Likud, led by Yitzhak Bodai, a very important former member of the Liberal Party, and those of you may or may not know, the Liberal Party prior to this election formally joined Likud. So Likud and the Liberals, Herut and the Liberals actually became now officially as a united political party. But there were many issues left unresolved in terms of how the organizational branches of the two political parties actually would be amalgamated, how the allocation of safe spots on the candidate list between the two political parties in the upcoming Knesset elections would be allocated. So there were questions. There was lots of room for disappointment and disgruntling for members of the former Liberal Party. And so Modai's group, Modai together with four other liberals, Avraham Sharif being one of them, actually leave Likud, and they ask the Knesset House Committee to give them permission to form a new political party, PASI, the Party for the Advancement of the Zionist Idea. On the vote of no confidence, PASI actually supports the government, but thereafter immediately takes a very interesting centrist position and weighs very carefully the conflicting and competing offers that are coming in from Shamir and from Perez, trying to decide which way to go and which major political party to allow to come back and form a new government. PASI, a number of very important defections take place. Avraham Sharir not only joins Modai in leaving Likud, but while Modai is trying to decide which of the two alternative possibilities to support, Shari actually goes on record and telling the Israeli public that no matter what the rest of his colleagues think, he is going to join Shimon Peres and he is going to support the formation of a left religious coalition. In the end, he's not going to do that. One more time, he's going to change color and he's going to come back to Likud to support the reformation of Yitzhak Shamir's government. Yitzhak Peretz, again, a nominal leader of Shas, and I say nominal because Shas is, of course, under much stronger religious leadership than secular. And two members of the Ashkenazi religious party, Eliezer Mizrahi and Avraham Verdiger, also threatened to leave Aguda. One of them actually does, Mizrahi does, arguably under strict instructions from the United States, from the Lubavitcher Rebbe, who tells him that you cannot be part of a political party or any movement that would support the formation of a left, of an alignment left coalition, because after all, these people don't give kosher, they eat pork, and you know, you just can't do that. And then those kinds of arguments also came up in major rallies, and in one particular major rally organized by one of the other Orthodox parties at the time, Degel HaTorah. The last major defector, whose defection actually made it finally possible at the very end of the process for Shamir to reform the government, was Ephraim Gur, the representative of, if you will, the Georgian constituency, former mayor of Ashdod, or Ashkelon, one of the two, who barely made it into the Knesset. He was either the last or the second last from the bottom up on the list to actually make it to the Knesset. And Shamir offered him a deputy ministership if he crossed the floor, and he did. So you see that in this whole process between the vote of no confidence and determining who will form the new government, not only political parties are changing positions, but individual politicians are also changing heart. In the end, on the day when Perez is invited to show if he has a majority on the floor, he thinks he does. He actually shows up when he sees that some of his allies didn't actually come to the Knesset. So it's a very embarrassing moment with his wife and many friends in the audience, in the visitors' gallery. Perez asks for an extension, but fails to form a new government. Yitzhak Shamir tries, and together with all the defectors whom I mentioned, he's able to form a new center-right coalition government. Okay, so we see that parties didn't behave as unitary actors. Labor suffered defections, Likud suffered defections, the religious parties suffered defections. So what's wrong with the theory? Is anything wrong with the theory? Not necessarily, and this is of course the central puzzle that I mentioned earlier. And so in order to get a crack at this, I want to draw on a very interesting perspective that has been applied to similar questions in the literature, looking at the Italian legislature, the Japanese legislature, where defections are far more rampant than in Israel, but the insight, I think, can actually help us understand this very important turning point in Israeli history. Because you can't emphasize enough how important the stinking trick and this episode was. Out of this moment in Israeli political history come major institutional reforms. The anti-defection law, which has become part of the basic laws of Israel, the institutional reform to bring about the direct election of the prime minister, they are all responses to the very tumultuous period in the Knesset and in the Israeli public and electoral politics that I have described. So what I would like to do is to take and just show you in the remaining 2-3 minutes the gist of a power index oriented approach. So it works as follows. Every political point, the name of the game in coalition politics is getting a majority, right? So depending on how important a political party is in getting a majority, it has a certain amount of power. Now you look at this very simple legislature with 3 parties. It's a 10-seat legislature, a majority requires 6, right? 2 parties have 4 seats each, 1 has only 2. Everybody has the same amount of power, 1/3, right? Because there are 3 minimally winning coalitions possible. A with B, A with C, or B with C. Everybody, every political party is 1/3 of the time needed in order to bring a majority coalition about. So even though the numerical distributions are uneven, the small political party is just as powerful as the larger political party. Now, and here comes the insight from the Japanese and the Italian literature. And that works if you assume that parties are united actors. But in a larger political party, that power value, that 1/3 of the power that, let's say, party A or party B or party C commands, gets divided differently depending on how big the party are. So simply take the power index value in the second last column and divide it by the size of the party in the parliament or in the legislature. So you will see that smaller political parties, members of smaller political parties, actually have greater power in coalitional dynamics because the same amount of party power gets distributed, divided by fewer members. Here I wanted to show you an example. Okay, so if these are the parties, What were to happen if one of the parties actually split, right? What were to happen if party C, what were to happen, let's take this arrangement, sorry, I'm changing a slide to a different example, sorry about the slide. So look at this, you have party A with 4 seats, party B and C with 3 seats each. Again, each party has the same amount of power, 1/3, but when you divide them, you'll see that members of party B and C, because they are smaller, they actually, individual members of those parties are more powerful, and you see those in the values in the last column, 0.11 versus 0.08. Now, what were to happen if, let's say, party C gets broken up? No, party A. So what happens if party A suffers a defection? You can think of Ephraim Gur leaving Labour, you know, one person leaving one of the larger parties, and nothing changes. It doesn't make sense to defect, right? Because that one person doesn't actually, is not going to be able to make an impact in terms of becoming a pivotal player in calculating the voting indices. So the point is that there are certain distribution of seats and voting powers under which parties will be stable. Let me bring you to another scenario, something like this, which shows us, which is now bringing us closer to the Israeli reality in 1990. Take this parliament, two parties with 4 seats each and one party with only 2 seats. Each party has the same voting power as we saw before, but members of party B are more powerful relatively. What happens if, in this case, party C suffers a defection? So now you see that the defector's personal power value is 0.083 relative to 0.0825 if you see in the last row before. The point is, the mathematics, the math here shows a small difference, but the point, theoretically, for us, what's important is that there are distributions of seats and there are distributions of power values under which it makes sense for politicians to defect, because they will be more powerful in affecting the formation of various other majority coalitions. Now, let me show you very quickly what the numbers actually were for the Knesset. And in 1990, or after the 1980 election. I just ask you for now to look at the first column and the last column. The first column shows the parties. Zero in on the red, Likud and Alignment. You see that they were 1 seat apart after the election. Likud had 40 seats, Alignment had 39 seats. In terms of their voting power, the parties, Likud was a little bit more powerful. Likud commanded just over 23% of the total voting power, which is based out of a total of 1, and the alignment was commanded 1/5 of the total, so 20% of the total voting power. But when you divide this by the number of members in the party, you see that you see the small difference, but they were very weak. So it didn't really make much sense to remain a Likudnik or a member of the alignment if you compare how much more powerful members of the smaller political parties were. So, for example here, if you were one of the 2 members of Shinui, your voting power was 1.3. If you were one of the members of the much bigger Likud, your voting power is 0.58. So it makes sense for someone like Ephraim Gur to want out of alignment, become a single member party, have far greater power, and negotiate a deputy ministership for him. It made sense for Modi and Pazi to say bye-bye to Likud, form a small 5-member group with far greater personal power value to them than what they would have had in Likud. So the point is that there was a very important logic, institutional, mathematical logic to what went on in the Knesset. In which case, perhaps some of the reforms were a bit overblown and maybe a bit premature. Because this was really a very unique moment in Israeli history that such distributions of power indices we saw, together with a moment of government instability. Although the Knesset itself has been much more fragmented since then than it is now, and that's really an important point to take. The number of parties in the Knesset, the fragmentation of the Knesset today is far higher than it was in the 1990s. But some of these problems wouldn't recur because the small parties don't carry the same relatively greater amount of power than the larger parties do. So if that's the case, then Israel has something very important to tell us about why and under what conditions political parties themselves may or may not survive intact or may suffer defections as part of a coalition crisis. Again, the logic is very similar to what goes on in Italian and Japanese and the Japanese parliament, even though here the incidence is, or the number of cases is more limited. I'll stop there. Thank you very much.